Good morning. We welcome you to this virtual gathering of Fellowship Baptist Church. We're glad to be with you, at least in spirit, this morning. And we long to be with you together here once again, hopefully in the near future, as that is what our prayer is. We have some offerings. Well, that is the first announcement. We have some announcements to begin with this morning, and the first one has to do with the offering. We announced last week that we were working on getting an online option available on our website, and that is not quite ready yet. We're still working on that. The deacons are working on that, and you will receive an email as soon as that is available. In the meantime, you are still able to send in your offerings via mail. You can, if you happen to need the address, it's right here, 4625 Cleveland Heights Boulevard, and you can send that in. The mail is picked up every day, that has some security to it. A couple other announcements to look at. One, we have youth ministries and children's ministries, and those continue even during these times. We have a virtual Awana that the commander, Eileen Sutton, has been putting together. I have several kids that have been taking advantage of it, saying their verses to their leaders over the phone. If you're part of our Awana program and have not heard of this, make sure you send the office an email to get the information. It's a Facebook group and you'll need to be invited to it. They update their units at 4 o'clock every Wednesday. There's Bible lessons, there's even games. And then there's the opportunity for the leaders to connect with their students via phone to, again, listen to the verses and just be able to see how their clubbers are doing. Youth group as well is still going. We have two virtual sessions, one each Sunday night at 7 o'clock, where we're currently going through the Sermon on the Mount with the teens. And then also on Wednesday during the normal youth group time, 7 o'clock, we're meeting together via Zoom. And if you have a teenager that hasn't been able to take part in that, maybe you haven't gotten the emails, please send us an email at the church office so we can get you that information. For security purposes, we make sure we send out the password and information on that to people that are part of our youth group or that we personally know. Also, coming up on April 13th, we usually have a Monday evening men's group that was meeting weekly and then one that meets monthly. Well, the weekly one has been put on hold, but the monthly group will still meet together, but again, via the internet. And so we'll have a room or a web seminar or web chat via Zoom that if you're part of that men's group, make sure that you have your email address in with the office and we'll send you that login information. I'll meet next Monday at 7 o'clock. Well, that's all the announcements we have. I'm going to turn it over to Pastor now as we open this morning's worship service in prayer.
Thank you, Daniel, for those announcements. And usually here at Fellowship Baptist Church, we have a lot more going on. But as you could tell, because of this special circumstance with the COVID-19 virus, life has greatly changed. I also, as I will open the service in prayer, I also come as a pastor with a heavy heart because we have actually had one of our members test positive. And we have another that is being tested and probably will come out as positive as well. And so now we are a congregation who has been touched by this devastating disease, although both of our members are doing quite well, at least at the time of this recording. And so let me just mention before I would bow how that our hearts go out to all of those who have been affected by the COVID-19 virus. Those especially in New York and New Orleans and other places in Louisiana, for California, Colorado, other places that are hot spots, and others that are just waiting for Miami and our own state. We want to, as Christians, never forget that this is a real circumstance with real people dying. And there are real families that are hurting, even as we record this this message and this service. Would you bow with me as we pray? Our Father in heaven, how we thank you and praise you that you are the God of the heavens and you are also the God of this earth. Our Father, today we thank you and praise you that of you and through you and for you are all things. and that this does not catch you by surprise, that you are the sovereign God accomplishing your purposes on the earth. Our Father, today we do think of those that have been affected by this terrible virus, and for some of the sickness and devastation of life and of health, and also of just removing life. Father, we commit ourselves unto you. May everyone who is listening today know the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior. If not, to seek him out and be found. Father, may you work through even the songs, the prayers, and the music of this particular recording so that others would be able with us to glorify our great God. We thank you for the privilege now. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, everyone. I have a confession to make. I know that later on in this service, Pastor Dan's going to do the confessional, but I have a confession to make. I miss you all. I miss handshakes, hugs, and high fives, the three H's of Fellowship Baptist Church. I can't wait to get back together with all of you and greet one another and be with each other again. But for now, this morning, let's do our virtual worship. Hymn number 204 in our hymn book is Rock of Ages. I'd like you to stand where you are. Stand and join me as we sing together.
Rock of Ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee. Let the water and the blood from thy raven side which for me of sin the double cure. Cleanse me from its guilt and power, not the labor of my hands can fulfill my law's demands. Could my zeal no respite know? Could my tears forever flow? All for sin could not atone. Thou must save, and thou alone. Nothing in simply to thy cross I cling, naked come to thee for dress, helpless look to thee for grace, foul I to the fountain fly, wash me, Savior, or I die. While I draw this fleeting when my eyes shall close in death, when I soar to worlds unknown, see thee on thy judgment throne. Rock of Ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee.
Very good.
Well, if you are tuning into our service for the first time, this is the part of our service where we traditionally read part of the London Baptist Confession of Faith of 1689. We do this for a couple of reasons. One, because it's a good document. The authors look through Scripture and they look at what Scripture teaches about certain subjects, and they try to put that together in a concise statement. It also helps us as a church to link ourselves with history. My theology professor taught me that if you come up with a new thought, chances are very good that you've come up with a wrong thought when it comes to Scripture. God's word has not changed. And so when it comes to theology and how we look at Scripture, If we're looking at it differently than the people and the theologians in 1689 were looking at it, then we probably have a little bit of a problem, because we do not want to look at Christ differently than how Christ revealed himself in Scripture. And we are looking at Christ this morning through the London Baptist Confession of Faith. So follow along as we look at Christ, and specifically in this first section of Christ as the Mediator. It reads this way: "To give effect to his eternal purpose, God chose and ordained the Lord Jesus, his only begotten Son, in accordance with the covenant into which they had entered, to be the mediator between God and man, also to be prophet, priest, and king, head and savior of his church, also to be the heir of all things and judge of the world. From all eternity, God had given to his Son those who were to be his progeny, and the Son engaged in time, as distinct from eternity, to redeem, call, justify, sanctify, and glorify them." Now, in our copies of the London Baptist Confession of Faith, underneath this section, it lists all of the scriptures that the authors used to come up with that statement. And one of those should come right to mind as you're watching that, even though you can't see it. That last sentence, we see Romans chapter 8 just coming off the page, as it was God's purpose to redeem, call, justify, sanctify, and glorify those who are his own. Well, now we're going to turn from the London Baptist Confession of Faith, which was written by men. So it is not an inspired document, but it sought to look at what the inspired Word of God said. We're going to turn from that and turn now to the inspired Word of God. It's Matthew chapter 21. This being Palm Sunday, we're going to look at the triumphal entry that's recorded by Matthew here in Matthew 21, verses 1 through 11. It's our custom to stand in honor of God's Word, since it is holy, infallible, and inerrant. Romans 21, verses 1 through 11. Matthew records, "Now when they drew near Jerusalem and came to Bethpage at the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, 'Go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them to me. And if anyone says anything to you, you shall say, "The Lord has need of them," and immediately he will send them.' All this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet, saying, 'Tell the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, lowly and sitting on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey.' So the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them. They brought the donkey and the colt, laid their clothes on them, and set him on them. And a very great multitude spread their clothes on the road. Others cut down branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Then the multitudes who went out before and those who followed cried out, saying, 'Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord! Hosanna in the highest!' And when he had come into Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, 'Who is this?' So the multitude said, 'This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth of Galilee. You may be seated.
That passage in the confession, the passage of Scripture, is all very meaningful. We want to remember today that we need to raise our gaze to keep our focus upon the greatness of our God, and to realize that out of love for neighbor and for the concern of the health of each one of our congregation, that we have chosen to limit our freedom to come together this way. But we do it because of our love for the Lord Jesus Christ most of all. Would you bow with me as we have a pastoral prayer? Our Father in heaven, this morning we come before your presence with heavy hearts because of what's going on, not only in our country, our state, but even in the world. Father, there are people who have been affected by this particular virus around the world in over 150 countries. And Father, while that is hard for us to comprehend, as it is reported to us, we believe it to be true, and we are affected. Father, we are affected in our love and our compassion, and yet there's just so much that simply we cannot do. But we can pray, and we do so even now, coming before you to make a request that soon this plague would be able to be removed from us. But Father, in the midst of it, until that time, which brings you maximum glory, may we seek your face, and may we demonstrate the reality of Jesus Christ in our lives so that others may see, so that others would be drawn unto you. Father, keep your children away from reacting like everyone else in the world, but to be proactive in the things of God, to speak the things of God biblically, and Father, to show love of neighbor and love of God in the midst of all of this. We ask for your protection, your strength, and Father, your enablement. Embrace us in your arms of love as you accomplish your will in us. As we pray this morning, we pray for our president, our vice president, for their wives and family. Father, we pray for others in Congress, in the Senate, as well, for their protection, for their families, and ask, Father, that you would give them clear thinking in these days of difficult financial and economic composition. Father, as decisions are made and as things are going on, may they have your wisdom. Our Father, may you have your way with this country in the United States of America and in the world. Father, today we thank you and praise you for the protection that you have given. But we also pray for those that have been called upon you to go through this particular virus. Father, I think of those that have been touched here in our own congregation and ask that you might quickly raise them up and re-strengthen them, and that they would go through this death-like shadow trusting you. Our Father, this morning, we pray for others that are going through some hard times and difficult times, for our missionary family around the world, those in Spain, those in Italy, those in Madagascar, those in Africa, for those in Haiti. And Father, we just pray that you might minister each one of them. Our Father, we pray for those that are here in the United States as well, some traveling, some seeking to present ministries in local churches, yet local churches are not meeting in their church buildings. So Father, we just pray that you might meet the needs of each one of those. And for those that are even planning summer ministries, such as our own Camp Gilead, or of Lincoln and Jamie and their ministry around the world, Father, I pray that you would give them wisdom in making right decision during these times. Father, we pray for those that are sick and or weak, the elderly of our own congregation, that you would minister to each of them, whether it be Don and Rose, or it be Karen and Steve, for Chuck and Elsie, and for the many others that are in need of your protective hand. We commit them unto you and ask that you would work in their lives. For others that have some particular needs because they are on the front lines fighting in the medical profession. We think of our own Dr. Shalini. We think of those that are in the nursing realm. We pray for our two Stevens, and we pray for Peggy, for John Jensen, for Krista, for Natasha, for Trudy. Lord, for these and others that are ministering, may you grant them health, strength, hearts of compassion, good nights of rest, so that as they go back out each day, that they could have your hand of blessing. Again, we pray for those that have been touched by this virus in our own congregation, that you might continue to especially watch over them. Our hearts are heavy for them, and yet we rejoice that so far they're doing well. And so we praise you and thank you for that. Now, Father, as we consider some important things from your word in a few moments in this service, as we, with a real sense, have a sense of sadness because we cannot meet in our church building as a called out assembly of believers, yet we believe that as we show our compassion for our neighbor, as we seek to have a strong testimony in the community, in showing this love and concern, may you bless, may you minister through us and to us according to our needs and your glory as we commit ourselves unto you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Tongue confess he reigns, lift up his name and praises forever proclaim. The glory of the Lord, make known his mighty deeds to all, take up the call, let every nation know. He is our Messiah, our Savior and our King. Let all our voices join as one and fill the earth with singing. Glory to our God, his greatness we applaud. Let every race on every shore proclaim the glory of the Lord. Proclaim the glory of the Lord. Give honor to the Prince of Peace, for if we cease, the stones will start shouting. Proclaim the glory of the Lord. With voices lifted, let us raise immortal praise to him who reigns on high. He is our Messiah, our Savior and our King. Let all our voices join as one and fill the earth with singing. Glory to our God, his greatness we applaud. Let every race on every shore proclaim the glory of the Lord. The glory of the Lord, he is our Messiah, our Savior and our King. Let all our voices join as one and fill the earth with singing. Glory to our God, his greatness we applaud. Let every race on every shore proclaim the glory of the Lord.
Thank you for that special, Daniel. We want to keep with that same theme, proclaim the glory of the Lord. This song is called Creation Sings the Father's Song, and it is a joyous song. In the chorus, it uses the word, hallelujah, let all creation stand and sing, hallelujah. And that word hallelujah simply means praise the Lord. So let's do that as we sing together with this wonderful song.
Creation sings the Father's song. He calls the sun to break the dawn and run the course of day till evening falls in crimson rays. His fingerprints in flakes of snow, his breath upon the spinning globe. He charts the eagle's flight, commands the new. Baby's cry, hallelujah. reconciling God and man. A second Adam walked the earth, whose blameless life would break the curse, whose death would set us free to live with him eternally.
Videotape this particular service for Fellowship Baptist Church, and for those that are listening, this is Palm Sunday weekend. It's a time in which a lot of people attend church and with the sense of excitement of what's going to happen here next week with Easter. Well, because of our pandemic and because of COVID-19, that and the decisions of those in places of leadership, that has been brought kind of to a conclusion. It was nice that our own governor took and recognized that churches are essential. However, we are still going to be videotaping because it is still kind of dangerous, and I do hope to have more than 10 people in attendance in my church for a public assembly. But that brings into question, during this time of leadership in the time of trial, when I even think about the historical account of what is actually going on in the world and the question of leadership, that same thing was actually at the heart of what was going on at the time of the triumphal entry and Palm Sunday. So if you have your Bible, turn with me to the Gospel of John and chapter 12. The Gospel of John and chapter 12. Now, I have been going through the Gospel of John verse by verse, and as we approach chapter 12 and the account of the triumphal entry, I kind of bounced around a little bit, went a little bit ahead, and then wanted to come back so that I would be able to save this particular message for Palm Sunday. However, little did I realize that it would also very much play into what we would be doing on Palm Sunday, videotaping a service because of a pandemic in this particular world. And so we find ourselves in this particular passage. Our song service even was in preparation for some of the things that are going on. Something that is missing here, that when the religious leaders were questioning the whole Hosanna passage there as Jesus went into Jerusalem, that they were all concerned about what that was going to imply and what that was going to do. In our passage, we're going to find out that the Pharisees were actually afraid that the whole world was going to follow Jesus. And yet Jesus said that if these do not cry out, the stones will cry out. Now, I know stones don't have vocal cords or mouths to do that, but somehow in my thinking, I am enough of a literalist to think that they would have done something to show forth the praises of God in this triumphal entry of Jesus going into Jerusalem. The Bible does say that the world and all of creation groans and travails until the day of redemption. Jesus says in this particular passage, "My hour has come." He prayed about it in John chapter 17, that his hour had come, and asked the Father to glorify him, and that restore the glory that he had with the Father before the world was. And that's going to set up for the services of our whole day. But also, those are the kinds of things that we need to be reminded of as we come to this very familiar passage. But I think that maybe we're going to take a fresh look at it and notice some important things that are here. Well, as I like to do as we come to a passage of Scripture, and it's been a couple of weeks since we have been able to have a message or have this message in the Gospel of John, I want to just very quickly set it forth and to say that the Gospel of John, written by the apostle late in the first century, separate from the other Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, which are called the Synoptic Gospels, meaning that they're a synopsis of the life and ministry, kind of the person and work of Jesus Christ, and kind of gives a biography or a biographical look at the Lord Jesus, that the Gospel of John has a different purpose. While it does do biographical material, it records things, some things that we can go and compare to the other Gospels, such as the triumphal entry that is found in all four of the Gospels. But the Gospel of John was written on a purpose. It was written, first of all, that according to chapter 20, that these things are written that you may believe. And so these things are written for those that would have some questions about the Lord Jesus Christ. Was he really the person that he said he was? Is he really Messiah? Is he really God incarnate? Is he God in the flesh? Is he the God-man? And that was beginning to be questioned early in the first century. And John, being led of the Spirit of God, wrote this particular gospel to help fight that doctrine that was being proposed, that Jesus was only a man. We even have that kind of thing going on in this day and age, and that want to take away the deity or the godness, the God reality of the Lord Jesus, that he is the God-man. And so that was one of the purposes of the epistle, or I'm sorry, not the epistle, but the Gospel of John. The second is that it is to teach us who really is this Christ. And I think that becomes extremely important when we come to this particular passage. The book or the gospel begins with, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Such was in the beginning. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us." And so it is the eternal Word that it became flesh, which is the Lord Jesus Christ, that teaches us preexistence. It teaches his deity. But it also teaches us that we got to get Christ right. And as Jesus is going to say through and has said so far up and through chapter 12, that he was sent of the Father and that he was the fulfillment of Old Testament prophecy. He is the Messiah, the one who was promised. He was the promised Son, even pictured in John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. That is the only unique Son of promise. That Jesus Christ was the one who to fulfill Old Testament promises. Now, the prophecies of the Old Testament concerning Messiah, sometimes they got kind of confusing. And sometimes on this side of the cross and this far in having the Old and the New Testament, we can decipher most of that. Not all of it, I don't think, but most of those things a little bit more clearly. But they had a difficult time because we have, even in, for example, the book of, or the prophet Isaiah, that in Isaiah, you've got the suffering servant, and then you've got the conquering king. And they were having a hard time understanding that. And even in our passage that we're going to be looking at today, that what we have is I think, a lot of misunderstanding. Some people believe that actually Jesus came to present the kingdom and that this was going to be it. And if Israel would believe, then Messiah would be here. There would be no such thing as a church as we would understand and know it today. And that was it. But since Israel rejected Christ, then many believe that actually the crucifixion and other things that are going to happen here in the church was actually God's plan B. I do not believe that that is true, and there are several reasons for that. But for that, to prove that, we got to look at what was revealed in another gospel. So while I had you go to John chapter 12, we haven't expanded it yet, or I haven't read from it yet, you may want to listen to some words that are found in the Gospel of Mark. In the Gospel of Mark chapter 10 and verse 32, we read these words. Now, this is before the triumphal entry. This is before the raising of Lazarus from the dead. And we read it, he introduced it, says, "Now they were on the road going up to Jerusalem, and Jesus was going before them. And they were amazed as they followed, and they were afraid. And then he took the 12 again aside, saying, and began to tell them of the things that would happen to him." Now he had said this before, but this is on the way going up towards Jerusalem. "Behold, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be betrayed to the chief priest and to the scribes, and they will condemn him to death. They will deliver him to the Gentiles, and they will mock him, and they will scourge him, and they will spit on him and kill him. And the third day he will rise again." Wow. Those were words of prophecy of the Lord Jesus, just very, very short period of time before they actually were fulfilled. And so with that, within the next couple of weeks, that's going to happen. And so it wasn't that, he was going to give it his best shot, plan A, and then go plan B. No, it was the eternal, determinant will of God that Jesus Christ would die upon the cross of Calvary. He was the lamb slain from before the foundation of the world in the eternal decrees of God. That there wasn't a plan A or plan B. There was only one plan, and it was the plan to uplift and glorify the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we read in this particular passage now, as we get ready to go into it, of the triumphal entry. Now, in the Gospel of John, it is just a very, very brief passage. I didn't necessarily go through and compare all of them, but I would say that the Gospel of John is the shortest account of the triumphal entry that we have. But listen to it, and then we're going to take a look and see how it fits into the Gospel of John. And I want you to notice five important things in John's account of this triumphal entry. Follow along as I read. Beginning of verse 12, this is John 12, 12. "The next day, a great multitude had come to the feast. And when they heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem, and they took branches of palm trees, and they went out to meet him and cried out, 'Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel.' Then Jesus, when he had found a young donkey, sat on it. As it is written, 'Fear not, daughter of Zion. Behold, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt.' His disciples did not understand these things at the first, but when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered those things that were written about him and that they had done these things to him. Therefore, the people who were with him, and when he who is called Lazarus out of his tomb was raised with him, bore witness. For this reason, the people also met him, and because they heard that he had done this sign. And the Pharisees therefore said among themselves, 'You see that you are accomplishing nothing. Look, the world has gone after him.'" Now, that's kind of an interesting passage of scripture. And we went on to see their response, and we will do that this morning as well. But I want us to consider this account. Now, it's kind of interesting. There's an awful lot left out. Now, let me just say that because it is left out does not mean that it's not important. It just is not important for the purpose of John and in the purposes of John in including the account. There were many things in the life of the Lord Jesus that we have no recollection of. We have no record of. We don't know what happened in many, many circumstances. But those things, it isn't that they weren't important. It's not that they are for us or that they are necessary for us to understand. But as the Holy Spirit used John to pen the book of the Gospel of John, we have these important things to give us what John wanted to communicate in his polemic or his little sermon or his writing so that other people would properly understand what it was that he was saying. I find it interesting, for example, that as he quotes in verse 13, there's this addition after Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Then there is this addition to that quote, the King of Israel. Now, was he adding to scripture? No, he's writing scripture. And so we read up later on that then he quotes in verse 15, fear not, O daughters of Zion, behold, your king is coming. So the concept of the king and that he was their king, that is within the context. I think that's going to be key when we take a look at this and notice some things that are particular about this. Not only that, but then later on it says in verse 14, when Jesus, when he had found a young donkey, sat on it, and then it said a donkey's colt. Well, those are just statements. Well, if we go to the other gospels, the synoptic gospels, we find out how he sent the disciples and that there's going to be a man that's going to say, what are you doing? And you're going to, you know, and then they respond and he says, and you tell him that the Lord has need of these and then he'll let you have them. And so the rest of the story is given in another gospel. It is not so much the purpose of John on those minute details. We can get those details somewhere else, but there's no contradiction of what we have in this passage and with the Gospels which had been written years before in the Synoptic Gospels. So just to make those things kind of clear. Now, what I want to do is as we come now to this particular passage, I want to consider five important things to notice in John's account in this triumphal entry. The first thing is this. It is important for us to notice the dramatic change in the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, this is just true because we know the other synoptic gospels. The first century readers would have known about those gospels, and they would have known by way of experience the very ministry of the Lord Jesus. The ministry of Christ, if you had to take a look at it, early in his ministry and as it was developing, he was very well accepted and had much that he could do, and the people followed him, and they would come. There were those that did not like the fact that he was from Nazareth, and so you even have Nathanael's response. But what we have in the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ, that there was individuality and the emphasis on the individual. Now, big crowds did come. I mean, he did feed 5,000 plus women and children one account, 4,000 on another, and the crowds would come. They would push upon him. He had to even get in a boat and go out, and he would preach to many people. But yet we would read in the Gospels that, and many went back, for they followed him no more. The immediate context of this, and if you think about the Gospel of John, John's emphasis is more on the second half and really the very end of the ministry of Christ, when the Pharisees, they hated Christ. They were looking for opportunities to take Christ. They tried to get him when he would use that great phrase, the ego eimi, the I am, I am. And he said that before Abraham was, ego eimi, I am. And so they got it and they were out to get him. Then when Jesus decided to heal a man born blind, and it was the Sabbath day. That's very close to this. That became very offensive to the leadership, so much so that we're given this little bit of information that if you were to become a follower of Jesus, you got kicked out of the synagogue. And that way they were able to influence people, keep people from following it. And there was a sense, not secrecy, but there was a sense of smallness, a sense of individuality. Jesus had 12 men that he was working with, and groups would come. And then right before this account in chapter 11, John writes that Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. And the emphasis there was Lazarus, Mary, and Martha. Now, there were other people present, but it wasn't the big crowds any longer, for they had stopped following Jesus. And so there is now it seems that his influence and ministry is going down. However, when Jesus is going to say in verse 23 here, but Jesus answered them, that's this group that came and visited him, the hour has come that the Son of Man should be glorified. He had said at the first sign miracle that his time had not come. Now he says, my hour has come, and he's going to go into Jerusalem, and he's going to fulfill those things that were stated in the Gospel of Mark about being tried, handed over, crucified, and then be risen from the dead. That as those things were beginning to play out, that there were very few followers, and now he's going up to Jerusalem. It's the time of the Passover. God's Passover lamb is going to be offered upon the altar of Calvary, in a real sense, upon the cross. And what do we have? He's going up, riding on a little donkey. This is, they're smaller than what we have here in the United States and what we tend to breed for today. But he's riding on this in fulfillment of scripture. We'll see that in a moment. But then what happens? The crowds start coming. They hear Jesus is coming. We have to understand, we need to note the dramatic change in the ministry. Because they're still in Jerusalem and others along the pathway. And Jesus is coming. Did you hear? He's coming. Hey, he's coming. Hey, they want to kill him. He's over. He's going to be going maybe to the synagogue. And there's going to be sparks flying. And everyone comes out. But it was even more than that. For it seemed that the general population of the people, that they were following the Lord Jesus Christ. And they, in a sense, they believed his message. And so they were coming out. Now, because of, and there's a good historical reason, I'd encourage you to do some reading through one of my favorite authors, Dr. R.C. Sproul in Ligonier Ministries. He is presently with the Lord, but he wrote about the history of the importance of the palms and the palm branches and this particular time of the year and all of that. But just to say this, that is what they grabbed. They got the palm fronds, the palm leaves, and they're bringing them out, and they're going to lay it down, and then they begin to shout. And it appears, as you compare in the other Gospels, that they begin to shout and praise God and taking their cloaks off and just having a gigantic celebration. Why? Because this dramatic change is he's going to Jerusalem, and he's not going to be coming back out the same way. And so we need to note that in this particular passage, in the triumphal entry, that he has gone in as the hated prophet, loved by generally the people, as we're going to find that they were seen here. At this particular time, we see the dramatic change in the ministry and the number of people. For even the Pharisees said, therefore, they said among themselves, what are we accomplishing? We're not winning this battle with Jesus because look, the world has gone after him. Now that's hyperbole. That's when the world and the whole world doesn't always mean every individual person, but it's a word of hyperbole that the fact that it looks like everybody's following him. This is a big, big crowd. So while up to this point it was subdued, now it's full public. He has said his hour has come, and there appears to be wide acceptance. Now, that's important to remember because we're going to notice something else later on. So the first thing to notice in the triumphal entry is a dramatic change in the praise. And it appears that Jesus never really, in that particular ministry, really wanted to be in the limelight, even in the changing the water to the wine. It was his mom that came to him. They didn't bring a big committee or anything. And as when he raised Lazarus from the dead, well, there were the mourners there. He didn't seek them. They were already there. But now, there was this public recognition. That's interesting. The second thing to notice in all of this is to notice the entirely voluntary nature of his going to his suffering. Now, we know from the Gospel of Mark that he already said, this is what's going to happen. Now, I don't know about you, but if I kind of knew that, well, if I drive to Bartow today, I'm going to be put to death, I might avoid going to Bartow. You know, that I don't know. Now, maybe if some sheriff or the police take me there, I'm going to be forced to go. But that is a tough thing to think, that you would go of your own free volition and of your own free will. Yet Jesus did that very thing. His previous instruction, he said, this is what's going to happen. Remember, even when he told the disciples about it, and John said, no, you know, and the disciples gathered around and said, no, don't do this, don't do this. And Jesus said, I have to. It was also the fact that the nature of his going and his suffering was so forth, and his death, burial, resurrection was another verification of just exactly who he was. In the Gospel of John chapter 10 and in verse 16, for example, other sheep I have which are not of this fold, them I also must bring, and they will hear my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd. My Father loves me because I lay down my life, that I may take it again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have the power to lay it down, and I have the power to take it again. This commandment I have received from my Father. So he was in full recognition and in full voluntary will to go to Jerusalem, realizing that he would be put to death. Although it wasn't that they were going to take his life, he would lay his life down. He went willingly, voluntarily, and he would lay it down. And he says, one passage, no man takes it from me. I lay it down and I will take it up again. Again, John's purpose, don't forget that purpose of the Gospel of John, to point us to who this Jesus really is. Next week, we're going to be talking about the resurrection and the importance of the biblical and Christian doctrine of resurrection. Jesus is in full control in the midst of all of that. And it even comes out in his entrance into Jerusalem. So we notice this is all done voluntarily as he gets ready to go to his suffering. A third thing to notice in triumphal entry that becomes extremely important. We need to notice not only the dramatic change, the voluntary nature, but we need to notice the absolute accuracy of fulfilled prophecy. You know, God is not interested in 90% accuracy. He fulfills prophecy 100%. Because of this COVID virus pandemic and everything that's going on, and I feel for those daily reportings of those doctors with the president and vice president and all the questions that they keep being asked. And if they change anything, then everyone thinks, oh no, you know, what's going on? And boy, they don't know what they're talking about. Well, there's reasons for that. I have a degree in biology and we did plenty of experimentations. I hate to refer to all of this as an experiment, but that's how you gather data. You know, they talk about gathering the data. And you got to wait till the data becomes knowable. In other words, we don't know when this is over. We're right now on this stay at home kind of commandment from our governor. And how long? Well, it's for the month of April. Well, what if we come to the end of April and he says, well, we got 2 more weeks? Well, then people say, well, he lied. No, he doesn't know because the data is not all in. And so just in gathering data, if these doctors could have 25% accuracy, they would be overjoyed. if they could have 50% accuracy in all the facts. China didn't give us all the facts. We don't know what the full facts are. If we got it up to 80, 85% in a fallen world, I don't think he can do much better than that. But in the Old Testament fulfillment of prophecy, however, it is always 100%. In other words, you can count on it. I don't know if you want to do this or not, but we used to use the phrase, you could take that to the bank. So we've got this now of 100% accuracy, but notice the absolute accuracy of the fulfillment of prophecy. When he is on his way up, verse 13, they took branches of palm trees. They went out to meet him and cried out, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel. Well, let's take a look at that. We'll drop on down too. Let me just go read the other quote. It says, fear not, daughter of Zion. Behold, your king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt. Well, turn with me to the book of Zechariah. And Zechariah, keeping in mind this hundreds of years before the fulfillment of it, in Zechariah chapter 9, verses 9 and 10. Now, keep in mind, this is the prophecy. This is what the prophet Zechariah wrote down. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and having salvation, lowly and riding on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey. Wow. You know, many have said, why wasn't he riding a horse? Well, in the book of Judges, riding a donkey was not something that was considered weak or less showy. But at this particular time, Rome and horses and Jews and all that, that just wasn't going to take place. But that wasn't the prophecy. The prophecy was that he would be lowly and riding on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey. The next verse, verse 10, goes on. See, now that's kind of like this entrance of Messiah. But notice what it says, and I will cut off the chariot from Ephraim and the horse from Jerusalem. The battle bow shall be cut off, and he shall speak peace to the nations. His dominion shall be from sea to sea and from river to the ends of the earth. But notice it said that he would be cut off. Well, what do you do in that fulfillment of prophecy? It went exactly as the prophet Isaiah said. He comes into Jerusalem. They cry out and they are shouting this thing. The absolute accuracy of it all. That caused me to be remindful of the fact of in the book of Revelation, Jesus in his second return and in his coming again, we have in Revelation chapter 19, listen to these words. Now, again, these are words of prophecy that are not fulfilled yet, but the first one was fulfilled literally. I personally believe these will as well. Listen to these words. Now, the John, same author, John writes, now I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. And he who sat on him is called faithful and true, and in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes were like flames of fire, and his head and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no one knew except himself. He was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And keep in mind, this is John who wrote, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And his name shall be called the Word of God. And the armies in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, followed him on white horses. Now, out of his mouth goes a sharp sword that with it he should strike the nations. He himself will rule them with a rod of iron. He himself treads the winepress of the fierceness of the wrath of the Almighty. And he has on his robe and on his thigh a name written. And listen to this. King of kings and Lord of lords. The prophecy, Zechariah, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel. But in this coming, he's going to come in on a donkey. The second coming, he's coming in on a horse to bring judgment to all of mankind, to the nations. And there will be fire out his eyes, that there will be, he will be coming to judge with the fierceness of the wrath of Almighty God. Same author, same kind of an entrance, same emphasis, the King, only this time on the second coming, he comes as the King of Kings, not just the King of Israel. He comes as the Lord of Lords over all. Now you see, John had a purpose. John really enjoyed pointing people to Jesus Christ. So we need to notice this, that in the same author, in writing in the coming, first coming of going to Jerusalem to purchase our salvation, now in Revelation, he is writing concerning Jesus coming back to redeem all of creation in that great day to bring judgment unto them. So we need to notice the dramatic change in his ministry, public ministry here on earth, to notice the entire voluntary nature of his suffering, to notice the absolute accuracy of fulfillment of prophecy. And we need to note, in the fourth place, notice the state of the mind of the people that were here present. There was a crowd. This is seen in John chapter 12. And first of all, we got the response of the disciples in verse 16. They didn't get it. It says, and the disciples didn't understand the things at first, but they got it after he rose from the dead. Then we get the response of Lazarus and the people, verse 17, when it says, therefore, the people who were with him when he's called Lazarus out of the tomb and raised him from the dead bore witness. It appears that they had come along with him to Jerusalem. So he had all those people. And for this reason, the people also met him because they heard that he had done this sign. The Pharisees then looked and said, everybody. So you got the response of the people. They're coming along. They're saying, yay, Jesus, you're the King. And they're, Hosanna and blessed be the King of Israel. And they're all happy and everything. And by the end of the week, they're going to be crying out, crucify him, crucify him. And notice that John uses these words. It's going to go to our final point. Crucify him, crucify him. We have no, what was that term? We have no king but Caesar. That goes to the very purpose, I believe, on why John gave this miniature account of the triumphal entry, to emphasize the fact that he is the suffering Messiah, but he's still coming in as king. It was prophesied he would come in as king. He came in exactly as prophesied, and he's coming again, as he would write in that other book. So notice this, the state of the mind of the people. The disciples, they were a little bit confused. The crowd, they're going to become, they were excited at all of this, at the sign miracles and the recognition of who he was. And some say that the praise and worship of him. But then we also see the response of the Pharisees, verse 19. The Pharisees therefore said among themselves, you see what is, we are accomplishing nothing. Look, the world is going after him. They were at their wit's end. As he would go, their blood go into Jerusalem, their blood would continue to boil. They would become upset. How dare he come in here? And they had already given out thoughts. Watch for him. If he comes, we'll catch him and we're going to put him to death. Although they couldn't really do that because they didn't have the power of capital punishment. And that would take the Gentiles, just as he said, fulfillment of prophecy. So we've got these four important things to notice. The dramatic change in his ministry, voluntary nature of his suffering, the absolute accuracy of the fulfillment of Scripture, the state of the mind of the people that were all around in that day and age. But the last one, this one, we have to go further in the gospel to take notice. But I think in light of it all, I think everyone would recognize the fact, even if you don't believe this was even historically accurate, but just part of a story, that everybody would get it, that Jesus was wanting to be noticed as king, The people noticed him as king. Just like when they would come and they would ask him to forgive their sins and he forgave, he accepted the worship that they would bring to him or the recognition of just who he was. Now we have the triumphal entry. Crowds of people, multitudes of people, laying palm branches down, taking and recognizing, Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, King of Israel. And then again, the recognition of the prophecy, fulfillment of the prophecy of Zechariah. There was the notice, what we want to notice, the last notice is, we need to notice the king. We need to notice the Lord Jesus Christ and to see how this would fit into the book of the Gospel of John. Because you see, the term king was not only found in this particular passage. Take your Bible, and if you see, as we go further into this particular week, this last week of the Lord Jesus, when we go to chapter 18, and we know that in the beginning of chapter 18, Jesus is arrested. And we know that that took place and the things that they said concerning him. Judas has betrayed him and he is then taken to the trials and so forth. And I'm going to jump ahead and take a look at verse 33. This is when... let's look at verse 31. Pilate said to them, "You take him and judge him according to your law." Therefore the Jews said to him, "It is not lawful for us to put anyone to death, that the saying of Jesus might be fulfilled, which he spoke, signifying by what manner of death he should die." So you see the emphasis of, he is who he said he is. He is fulfilling all of Scripture. He prophesies 100% is proven true. The Jews said to him, "It is not lawful for us to put anyone to death." Drop on down now to verse 33. Then Pilate entered the praetorium again and called Jesus and said to him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" You see, John wants to emphasize to the Jews of that first of the first century and the early believers, who is this Jesus? Jesus is the king of the Jews. Now, he's been telling that to Jews all the time. Now, Pilate, a Gentile, asked him straightforward, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered him, "Are you speaking for yourself about this, or did others tell you concerning this of me?" Pilate said, "Am I a Jew of your own nation and chief priest have delivered you to me? What have you done?" And so we have that statement, the question rather, that Pilate says, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Verse 37, Pilate therefore said to him, "Are you a king then?" And so he brings it up again. Verse 39, "But if you have a custom that I should release someone to you," this is Pilate talking to the crowd, it says, "but you have a custom that I should release someone to you at the Passover. Do you therefore want me to release to you the king of the Jews?" Another Pilate, are you? He must have been at least convinced, at least even if it's in mockery. He then goes to him and says, "You want me to release? It's my custom. I'll release your king." John writes, because he wants to notice the king. Pilate noticed that. In chapter 19, the first four verses, now we get another picture of Jesus as king. So then Pilate took Jesus and scourged him. That's a heavy verse. So then Pilate took Jesus, the king, and scourged him. And the soldiers twisted a crown of thorns and put it on his head. And they put on him a purple robe. And they said, "Hail, King of the Jews." They struck him with their hands. And Pilate then went out again and said to them, "Behold, I am bringing him out to you, that you may know that I find no fault in him." Notice this. Then Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and put a purple and the purple robe. And Pilate said to them, "Behold the man." That is the man you call king. This is the man you call king. Look at him. He's bleeding. He's bruised. He's got spit running down his body. We've mocked him. This is what we think of your king, because Caesar, who is the real king, that's who you are to be looking at. Behold the man. Therefore, when the chief priests and officers saw him, they cried out, saying, "Crucify him, crucify him. You take and crucify him, for I find no fault in him." The Jews answered, "We have a law that according to our law, he ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God." And as we would go on and read other accounts, we have no king, but Caesar. The purpose of John, he wants us to notice the King, Jesus Christ. Well, in chapter 19, as we go on, verse 22, Pilate answers that what I have written. That's because he wrote in verse 21, and the chief priest of the Jews said to Pilate, "Don't write the King of the Jews, but that he said, 'I am the King of the Jews.'" Pilate says, "What I've written, I've written." Verse 23, then the soldiers went and they had crucified Jesus. They took his garment, made four parts, and to each soldier and the tunic. And now the tunic was without seam, woven of the top one piece. They said therefore among themselves, "Let's not tear it, but cast lots for it, whose it shall be, that the scripture might be fulfilled, which says, 'They divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots.'" Therefore the soldiers did these things. You see, this man was the King of the Jews, and they crucified him, even as he said. We are to behold him. He comes into Jerusalem, the King, the King. He goes before Pilate, the King. He goes before the soldiers, the King. He comes forth out of the grave, and the Apostle Paul would write that every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of the Father. Why? Because God has given him a name that is above every name. And then John finishes off the New Testament by writing these words. He comes on a white horse. His name is faithful and true. And we go on in that to judge the earth. And he will come. And this is what he is known as: the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. That's my Jesus. Is he yours? Getting Jesus right is what John wants us to do. They had a false recognition. They showed him in his weakness, and yet God glorified him. The significance of the triumphal entry is it's the end of his pilgrimage and his public ministry. It's going to begin in a real sense. It's going to be the forcing of the hand of his ministry. It's going to be demonstrating the perfect knowledge of prophecy as it plays out in his life. It will show the fickleness of the human heart. But we need to notice the King, the real subject of the passage of the Gospel of John and the triumphal entry. Getting Jesus right. Do you know this King? I trust that you do. If not, you need to come to him by faith. You need to trust in the living Savior who will accept any and all who come to him by faith. He will in no wise reject any. You need to come. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, how we thank you and praise you for what you have accomplished through the King. Our Father, I pray and ask that we would be found faithful in understanding that He is our King. He is our Savior. And he has done these things to bring glory to you and for our good. Father, I pray for any and all who have heard these words, that if they know not Christ as Savior, that they might believe on him who has been sent of you, Holy Father. We commit these words unto you to be used for your glory, as we pray it in Jesus' name. Amen.